Good morning.
Good morning.
And I'll just introduce myself shortly. I'm Dr. Talia Titiun, and I'm a clinical psychologist and managerial psychologist, as well as a hypnotherapist. And I work with people, treatments, hypnotherapy, psychological therapy, and also management consulting to top management and leadership training. So today I'm very honored to interview here Dr. John Butler. John Butler is the founder of HTI, Hypnotherapy Training International. He's the only one that was nominated by Gil Boyne to teach transformational therapy, and of course today we'll also relate it to transformational leadership, which is a very, very hot topic nowadays. And Dr. Butler has a very rich and vast experience in working with hypnotherapy training, group training, and also he worked with very big companies and corporates around the world. He worked with Goldman and Sachs. He worked also with Swiss Credit, right? And am I right?
Yes,
and
yes.
What else?
I've lectured for them in this country, Bupa, mm-hmm. Ernst & Young, big corporations.
Big corporations. Yeah. And what have you done with them?
What were the lectures topics? Covering topics such as performance improvement, performance enhancement. And there's topics to do with stress management and other topics which are very relevant to such, we've been just mentioning now about leadership, qualities mm-hmm. about how to handle interpersonal conflicts, interpersonal reactions, and all of the things that to do with then performance, which we can break down to creativity, motivation, and so on.
Yes, because the human mind is a mystery, and we really understand so little about it, and we're investigating that subject for so many years. Yes. So we want to give some of our experience and some of our tools to help corporations and leaders to thrive.
Yes.
And so let's start our first topic for today. Mm-hmm. And I thought to talk to you a little bit about stress management.
Okay.
So could you please share some of your experience working regarding stress management in organization, corporations, and so on?
Certainly, Talia. Well, stress, of course, is the organism's adaptation to all that's happening around it. Particularly, we think in terms of difficult situations, you know, interpersonal conflicts and so on. But stress is not the activity itself that we're dealing with. It's our response to what's happening. Your boss may be a stressor,
mm-hmm.
or your wife, or your personal life, certain things are stressful. But it's really how we respond, how we internalize, and
yes.
then bring resources to it or fail to bring
yes,
adequate
this is
resources.
Absolutely right. Mm. And basically, it's our perception of the threat because yes. we perceive this behavior or these actions as something that threatens us.
Mm-hmm.
So because we perceive it as something threatening, we tend to react with the stress response, which is very automatic and very mm-hmm. primitive response that we have it since old age, and we were triggered to respond
yes.
with the stress stimuli, with the cortisol and adrenaline and all those reactions automatically
uh-huh.
to stress. And once, when it was very useful for our survival in the jungle, today maybe it's not the best reaction when your boss is talking to you or correcting you or you're afraid of talking in front of audience and so on.
That's right.
So how can we relate to that, and how can we do it better nowadays when the stress is totally different and mm. our survivals totally different than in the jungle days?
Yes, of course. Well, you just say these are ancient mechanisms for survival, fight, flight, and freeze. Now, in terms of dealing with the problems that come our way, much of it is determined by, as you said, our internalization, how we believe we can cope or not, don't believe in ourselves or our abilities, and how to generate and mobilize our adrenaline, because cortisol and adrenaline, they're not all bad. It's simply that when we are not in charge of our, maybe using our bodies well, we don't know how to relax. we don't know how to use our minds well. Well, then these reactions are outside of our own mm-hmm. kind of control. We're feeling like we're the victim of these, feeling heart rate, blood pressure all raised, and we're feeling very stressed. As you say, the boss is criticizing mm-hmm. us. And so we need to be able to keep calm in the situation, physically, mentally, emotionally. And we need to have internal resources such as confidence, self-belief, motivation, mm-hmm. And be able to deal then with those anxiety states. Mm-hmm. And that's the biggest threat for most people that they're experiencing, that their mind goes into this fear the kind of mechanism. Fear that I can't cope, I won't succeed, fear that other people will be hostile to me, and so on. Now, when we begin to develop ourselves at the emotional level, and we begin, and this is often done through some small amount of therapy mm-hmm. or going into some training program mm-hmm. where we learn qualities of mental toughness, mm-hmm. Self-belief, self-acceptance, mm-hmm. and so on, then as we go into that personal development, mm-hmm. we're not dependent on other people in the same way. We're not so easily upset by their criticisms.
So that is a very important point, what you were talking about. So how can we train people in corporates, and how can we train employees and leaders and mm-hmm. managers? How can we help them to relax? How can we help them to cope better with stressors? Mm-hmm. How can we help them to perceive those things as not intimidating sure. or threatening, and yes. to help them thrive in the organization and really function much better when they're more relaxed and they can tap more into their potential? How can we give them tools to enable them to do that?
Well, that's our job. That's why we exactly. have these lectures, workshops, exactly. where we go into an environment, or we're also maybe dealing with people individually, mm-hmm. but we have group trainings as well, where they learn how to relax the body. They learn the physical relaxation, mm-hmm. progressive muscular and other forms
and
of relaxation.
And when you do the physical relaxation, you also give a signal to your mind that everything is relaxed, and you can relax, and you can relate to things more clearly in a more relaxed manner, right?
Absolutely. You learn to take mm-hmm. control and use your breathing, your saliva flow. You learn many techniques to calm your body, and these are techniques for active relaxation as well as passive relaxation. Times when you sit down, relax, go into a lovely meditative state, mm-hmm. but also when you're very active, like a long distance runner running against a clock or against his opposition, his opponents, he really has to be able to stay in the right mental state, which is active relaxation.
Now, which is like your zone, peak
flow.
Performance.
Exactly.
So it's not like that you need to lie on a couch and
no.
just to close your eyes and relax. That's only one part, and
yeah.
you can learn how to use your relaxation mechanism also in order to reach your peak performance or your optimal performance, let's say.
Absolutely.
Because you need also some arousal. It's not always the best thing just to be too much relaxed, but to find your optimal point between arousal and stress.
Which depends a lot on the perception you have of your own self, yourself, your abilities, and the level of the threat, and to see it as an opportunity. We need arousal to succeed, and we can label the experience then as more as excitement rather than nervousness, and we can control the nervous energy mm-hmm. and the adrenaline and have a very positive use of the adrenaline, the cortisol, and so on.
So you can teach people how to use it for their benefit.
Absolutely.
And how to know how to estimate the level that is good for them and
Absolutely.
To operate in an optimal manner. We can teach them to do that.
That's right. And the studies show that people who are able to achieve high levels of performance have an ability to use their own neural chemistry, their own body's responses, and also emotionally and psychologically to have the mental toughness to overcome fear of failure, mm-hmm. to be able to relax in the moment because they have self-belief, they draw upon past experiences automatically, they're able to visualize, use imagination, mm-hmm. the power of suggestion and programming as we teach them in clinical hypnosis. That's very powerful. I've worked with many high performers to optimize their performance, whether it's in creative arts, many, many film people, actors, actresses, and so on. And also with sports people.
Yes, so I'd like to talk a bit later about the peak performance, because this is a very interesting subject.
Of course.
But just let me ask you a quick question about burnout, because nowadays people, when they're stressed in organizations and they have long hours of working and sometimes they don't have the work-life balance, and sometimes there is a lot of pressures and lots of daily hassles that they need to deal with. So sometimes there is a lot of burnout, and so eventually people will be ill or lose their motivation and be more stressed. And so how can we deal with burnout? Can we prevent that?
Yes, because a lot of the times when people talk about burnout, they're often thinking about exhaustion and getting to the point of hypoglycemia almost. You know, they're drained, they're tired, they're using stimulants to keep going, they use food as a crutch, drugs as a crutch, or nowadays recreational drugs. They use cocaine, you know, in the business world sometimes to keep that level of arousal going, but it's very destructive.
Like we see in the movie, The Wolf of Wall Street, right? Wolf, yeah.
I've seen that actually happens in the worst cases in business life. Now, when a person knows how to use their own chemistry and is self-aware enough emotionally, they get a great combination of mind and body. Now, as you said, they can get exhausted, they're overworked, and they don't take enough rest. When you know the power of deep relaxation and you're not stressing yourself out in your everyday existence, because that's burning up a lot of energy that you don't need to waste. So you get a lot more done with less expenditure of energy. Now, of course, when you have to, well, we need to go into this in some depth because there's a lot of research on it. But just to pick up some of the key points, the physical side of relaxation, of active and passive, or this dynamic and active relaxation on the one hand, and this more formal, relaxed, passive relaxation, is very important to learn those skills. We teach the people those skills in maybe two or three sessions.
And then they can use it, it becomes also their second nature.
Second nature is bringing into all of the activities they do. They're conserving energy in what they do. And so
it's
just burning
like
it up.
Using their natural rhythm and the natural responses that can help inhibit stress and can help with their relaxation. And so we can use also those natural mechanisms if they know how to address it and to diagnose it.
Yes.
So they can really use it for their benefits, and then they can have more resiliency and prevent themselves from falling into unwanted stress and even burnout.
Yeah, they're becoming self-aware, as you say, with their bodies. They know that this is healthy. I'm feeling arousal, excitement, eustress, E-U-S-T-R-E-S-S, rather than distress, because we tend to think of stress as one thing.
So what is the difference between eustress and distress? Could you please elaborate?
Eustress stimulates us, helps us achieve things. It's necessary. It's part of our adaptation and survival and
like achievements. Like you were talking about people who deal with sports or athletes and so on.
Yeah, they have a healthy arousal. They're not getting overloaded, and they can tell the difference through self-awareness that I'm no longer getting myself exhausted, tired. So physiologically, their body is in a different position, a different level of activity. And those exciting states that they're in do the body a lot of good, actually. So eustress, it's beneficial. And at the emotional level, it's characterized by feelings that I have the ability, that the level of challenge, I'm up to it.
So to interpret those stimuli as a challenge instead of a stress or a threat.
That's right.
Or to interpret it as an arousal, or that you're enthusiastic about this mission.
Absolutely excited, motivated.
And not stressed about it. So it's all around about the perception, and then the perception affect our emotions and our behavior, and also the body mechanisms as well.
Absolutely. There's a lot, we don't have the time to go into at the moment, but there's a lot of research showing that for a human or an animal, when there's a sense of control, even something that might be painful, distressing, but if they believe they can escape or switch it off to some extent, there's a whole different effect on the body. So the loss of control often leads to feelings of helplessness, hopelessness, and then we go downhill. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, we have to be careful about our physical limits and resources and be able to take action with the external threats and so on. Being able to say no, if we talk about the emotional states, being able to be assertive, say no, stay motivated, and look for what you need and want in the situation, see the opportunities rather than just the threats. Mm-hmm. So you can turn the whole thing around to your benefit, and high achievers tend to do that, and they stay in a different mental state, even if it's not always pleasant or easy what they have to deal with.
But sometimes it's really important to step out from your comfort zone
in order to grow
and to achieve the targets that you're setting
And that's why stress is a part of growth. No organism, nothing develops without stress.
So not to interpret it as a bad thing.
That's right.
Or as a negative thing, but
yes,
rather as a thing that we can use and we can control and we can use to thrive and to
Absolutely.
Develop even farther. So
yes,
we talked earlier about peak performance,
mm-hmm.
and peak performance is something that people really use when they're athletes or in sport, or when they're in corporates, when they want to enhance their abilities and
yes.
to achieve even more and to reach beyond their limitations.
Yes.
So could you please elaborate more about what is peak performance and how it can be achieved?
Well, it's been known for a very long time that people can achieve states of mind in which things flow together better. Performance seems more effortless. You can look at people running in a top long distance runner, and mm-hmm. you can see that a certain stage of a person's activity, they get into a kind of flow. Their mind and body are working so well together, the muscles are relaxed, and then there's much less wear and tear on the body at the
yes,
time.
So there is a lot of research nowadays in positive psychology and
yes.
organizational positive psychology mm. about flow and how to achieve the flow state, and we can really teach people what mm. is their flow state and how to achieve this flow state and how to use it for their benefit and for
oh,
their...
Oh, yes.
A corporation benefit.
Absolutely.
Or mm-hmm.
And so the physical training we talked about earlier, that learning how to work with your breathing, and that's very, very important, has many aspects, has many long history in martial arts, yoga, and so on. And medical research is now validating a lot of that, how to maximize your metabolic state
mm-hmm.
and how that benefits your brain. Now, the mind, of course, the thinking we have is key because it activates the body in a way. So that if your mind is very positive, you're very confident, you visualize yourself as a winner with a success consciousness mm-hmm. rather than, oh, it's out of my control, or I'm not good enough, or I don't deserve it. Any of these other mental things we then have to work on. So it's a mind-body thing.
Yeah, and you know, it's very important to stress out that once a mind-body thing or used to be related to more holistic approaches, which seemed like more spiritual or hypnotherapy mm-hmm. was more of a spiritual thing mm-hmm, or a magical mm-hmm. thing. And nowadays there is a lot of evidence and lots of research mm-hmm. Using brain research and also lots of imaging that we're capable
yes.
of having conducting today, like fMRI.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
We can use that to see what's happening in the brain, and it's research-based, so we can really use those methods to enhance the performance and see how the performance is actually enhanced. We measure
yes.
it with brain scans and also with the performance itself
yes.
and the behavior itself.
Yes. I mean, for decades, it's been able to show that people were working very, very long hours and very tough jobs, but because they enjoyed it was their passion. They had very low levels of cortisol.
Mm-hmm.
Their
so
stress hormones
were down. Very important what you
yes.
actually say to relate it to meaningful,
mm-hmm.
To have meaningful targets, to feel that this is very meaningful to you, to ask why am I here,
yes.
why am I doing it, and to relate it to a very meaningful thing. And then you can even endure long hours of work or stress
That's
overload
right.
and because you know how to interpret it in a different
yeah.
Manner.
The meaning and purpose it has for you, the meaning and purpose you can give to it, how you can change your interpretation of a situation instead of saying, this is terrible, it's awful, what can I learn and grow from in this situation? The stumbling block becomes a stepping stone. You know, we have all the old sayings, the silver cloud, the cloud has a silver lining when you know how to look for it.
Right.
And so on. So that's very much training the mind to look for that and to be able to then approach it in a very proactive, I'm a creative being, I find creative solutions.
So proactivity is a very important subject here, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Because you feel that you are able to control your behavior, and to control your surrounding and the things that happen to you. And this also is a very important aspect
to
enhancing your positivity and to decrease your stress level, right? So I wanted to talk a little bit about...
Just to say very quickly on that, because we've just finished a course last week where people were using pain control. That's a major stressor.
Exactly.
If you have to have a medical procedure, a surgery. Mm-hmm. But to see people smiling through a surgery and being able to interpret what's happening in that way, and we're monitoring their bodies and we're showing that there's no stress. They're not just gritting their teeth and putting up with it. When you look at how the mind and body work together and we really begin to understand its incredible potential, physical stressors are not the same. Okay, it's cold, it's a long day. Sure, you have to look after your body and its needs, but you know you've got resources there. Now, mentally, the same. This is not a situation that I'm only just going to have to survive. I can thrive in it. I can turn it to my advantage.
So it's
resilience and belief.
Exactly. So it's moving from surviving to resilience and to thriving and to positive energy and meaningful acting upon meaningful task. And also, it's very important to stress out that if once leaders and people were looking more at the problems they need to solve, so they were aiming at decreasing the stress mechanism, so moving from minus to zero. Now we're not only talking about going from minus to zero, but also how to elevate there from from zero to plus. This is what we're talking also in positive psychology. And so we're not focusing only on the problems, but on the strengths, on the performance, how to enhance the performance, and how to achieve resilience and happiness and optimism and hope and to achieve and to apply your strength to work for you.
Absolutely. We're moving into a golden age, I think, about human, where we're discovering, begin to use human potential for the mass audience, for the world. So that where we've had a lot of research over the decades of how interpersonal conflict at work or in the family and relationships can bring down your health, give you great stress, how your financial situation, your health, you know, medical problems and so on. But what's been missing always is how to turn it around into the positive. You know, we've been able to look at life stress units and say, this is a high level of stress situation, this is a high level. And that's true, we can't be foolish about it, but then the other side of the coin is missing. How do you maximize your response to that situation?
So you can really use your strength, know your strength, know to diagnose them and use them in the workplace or in your life.
And not be the victim, not
exactly. Know how to take control, to feel that you're in control of the situation, and know how to build resiliency. So when things happen, and things always happen, but how can you...
And you need perseverance to push through.
Exactly,
yes.
Exactly. Because when you're resilient and you're motivated and you have attached a very meaningful thing to
that,
so you can really feel that you can go through all kind of obstacles and continue to go and to push forward, right?
And you have heard of the acronym GRIT, and you've heard of those words like resilience. Then they're very true. When we look at top performers, they've been through setbacks, they haven't had it all laid on a plate, they've learned from the setbacks. The bigger the stumbling block, the bigger the stepping stone is for your growth.
So let's talk about top performance and peak performance, and how can we learn from them and from their mechanisms, what they do, and how also leaders and transformational leaders can use this in order to motivate their people and to use those mechanisms to go forward and to achieve their goals.
Yes. Well, I think true leaders are people, there's the old-fashioned view of leaders, somebody tells everybody what to do. And that really doesn't develop people very much. And it often kind of assumes either a kind of fake charisma mm-hmm. or I should be this kind of person to lead others and speak authoritatively and take on a mantle of power, which maybe people are simulating a level of authority and knowledge which they don't have. Whereas when we really are inspirational to people, mm-hmm. it's coming from within the person. They walk their talk.
Exactly.
And they're more like guides to people because mm-hmm. they've walked there, gone in that path, they are able to show the way to others.
So they're more like models to other people.
They're models, that's
right. And they also can set goals which they believe their subordinates can achieve.
That's
right. Show them the model and support them, you know, give them the power and encourage them.
Help them discover their power.
Exactly. Help them discover what their strengths are, what their power is, and use a language and imagination and
yes.
symbols that really can relate to the other parts of their mind, not
yes.
only to the logical part, but they can really and truly use the other aspects of mind. So
yes.
what I found to be truth is that transformational leaders, they talk not only to the rational mind, but they talk also to the emotional mind. So
uh-huh.
can you relate to that a bit?
Yes. The inner mind, we often talk about the subconscious mind,
mm-hmm.
is the non-rational part. And it has its own feelings, beliefs, intuitions, and so on. There's many levels to it. And an effective leader is in touch with that, with power within themselves, our own inner power to motivate, inspire us, give us guidance, and so on, along with their logic, of course. Now, they're able to help other people discover that. It's about leaders are people who help other people be leaders, so to speak, leading in their own lives.
So help them to find their own leadership skills, their own leader inside, within them. So they will not be attached to the leader itself and just say, need to copy.
Another form of dependency.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. So they can be self-standing and resilient and not to depend on the leader.
Exactly. For decades, and I've taught this in corporations, is to lead yourself forward, to lead yourself and your potential out. The word educate means to bring things out in people, not just to give them information alone. That's the easier bit for most cases.
So when you have optimism and hope, and you have the resiliency
yes.
to cope with obstacles,
mm-hmm.
and you believe in yourself, so you're inspired and you mm-hmm. can really push forward and you can really get beyond your limitation.
That's correct.
So how does the transformation leader, the new leader, how can he lead the people that he's working with to outperform, to get to achieve peak performance and mm-hmm. to go beyond their limitations?
Sure.
Or it's like we call it, he inspires people to reach for the improbable.
Okay.
What tools can you use to get that?
That person, as we're saying, was somebody in touch with their own power, and they've achieved things in their lives, so they've walked the talk. Now, they're aware enough to not let their own agenda get in the way of other people and just feed off of other people's dependency. They're able to help other, they can see potential in other people that even the people themselves can't see, like a good therapist, and
mm-hmm.
help bring that out, help those people believe in themselves.
So they're like a good therapist, a good coach.
That's right.
They can see really those peoples and what their strengths are, and they can
yes.
help them to believe in their strengths and to lead them to act upon their strengths
absolutely.
And to achieve their true potential.
Yeah, absolutely. You mentioned the word optimism. There are people, those leaders, and it's not some kind of just cheerleading, superficial kind of happy, clappy optimism. They genuinely believe in human power and potential, that a human potential can solve any problem eventually.
So it's really more of a realistic optimism.
Realistic, mm-hmm. and the ability to inspire hope and confidence in people in their abilities, to point them to answers within themselves, to work collaboratively with them. There's many aspects of this, of course, we can't go into all the details, but as you said, can they use imagery and they can use suggestion, they use symbols, and they use all of the tools that are known to trigger inner states of potential, the inner potential states of belief and consciousness of possibilities. You said the improbable. Well, you know, who knows what's possible with the human mind? Who would have believed, you know, 200 years ago we'd have all these mobile phones mm-hmm. and, you know, spacecraft that go to mm-hmm. space probes to Mars and so on. And
that's so the human mind is a vast field. It's unbelievable.
Incredible.
And we only use a very small part of our brain and our potential.
Yes.
So with this tool, we can really outgrow and use more and really use more of our potential. And I wanted to mm-hmm. Give an example from the sports. Mm-hmm. For example, Roger Bannister, he was a British athlete, and he was the first one in the Olympics of, I think it was 1954, mm-hmm. if I'm not mistaken.
54.
He was the first one who could run a mile under 4 minutes. Until then, it was an imaginary boundary. Nobody believed that it can be reached. Nobody believed that it can be done. And after he had done it, so all of a sudden, in the same year, 7 more people succeeded to run this mile under 4 minutes. In the next year, 57 people succeeded to do that. So how can we explain that?
Well, of course, that example has become part of folklore. And the whole story is a bit more complex, but it's very interesting nonetheless. And there is a reality. Absolutely, in what you say, though, that when people have that belief that they can't achieve it or they're, whatever reasons they're blocking themselves, well, that's going to be their reality, more or less. They will never aim for it. Or if they do, they'll do it in a very much a way they mm-hmm. don't really believe. Mm-hmm. And so they won't achieve it. So we do have to have the power of belief, the power of programming and suggestions. We use it in clinical hypnotherapy.
Yes. And to know how to set the goals clearly and really to visualize them.
Absolutely.
And then maybe to relate emotions and feelings of success.
Yes.
And take some examples from the past when they could achieve their targets and how they felt, and to relate it to the present and future tasks that they want to achieve.
To draw on peak experiences of the past or high levels of performance, positive states, as we say, mm-hmm. we often talk about reinforcing them in certain disciplines. I like to use the word anchoring, which is forming an association that becomes a conditioned response, and we can condition our minds out of our conditioning, because we're already conditioned to have a lack of belief mm-hmm. in ourselves, to condition the mind through programming to take ourselves to a different level entirely.
So we can call it to turn the impossible to possible and the possible to impossibles, for example, to turn the unknown to known and the known to unknown.
Yes.
So to learn to step out of our comfort zone and to reach, deteriorate the limits, the limitations which are in our mind.
Absolutely.
And to know how to address the fear and to see it as an opportunity and to really develop ourselves and go forward to the next step.
Yes, and as you know from the course that you were, for what we were talking about last week, on the course, the principles of programming are very sophisticated to do that job well. So it doesn't just remain, like a belief. Okay, there's great power in the human mind, but
yes.
I don't really feel it for me,
yeah,
not
but
in this human mind.
It's very abstract, you know, it's just
yes.
many people say, think positive, be positive.
That's right.
Or believe it and you can achieve it, but there are specific rules and very scientific rules.
There are steps and
rules.
Stages you must go
exactly.
through.
Exactly, and you need to learn and to know how to implement it in your life. And this is what we're doing, teaching people
yes.
how to use those tools for their benefit and to achieve their goals and to achieve more of their potential.
Completely. We need to know the power of communication with our inner mind. How to do that? What are the rules, the steps and stages you go through as you do learning to be effective self-hypnosis and think for sports or for medical situations? And so language, verbal, nonverbal communication, mm-hmm. breaking all that down, looking at the mental states that, as you say, the value, the motivational value it has for us, the meaning, the purpose, all of the things that we're going to attach to the goal mm-hmm. and then the strategy to achieve the goal, it can't be just done with wishful thinking or a bit of happy clappy positive mm-hmm. mental states for
exactly.
a while.
Exactly.
That mm-hmm. doesn't last, that's superficial. It's better than being negative, but it doesn't take yeah. you where you need to
and
go.
And you know, thinking about what you say, a lot of high achievers in various fields, yeah. for example, in the sport field, Tiger Woods, he used a lot of imagining and self-hypnosis. Before he would play, he would imagine exactly yes. where the ball will land, how will it hit it, and how does it feel. Mozart himself even used it for creativity mm-hmm. and to enhance his abilities. And many, many, many top performers really, yes. really use those skills. And we can teach people how to use it for their own benefit.
Absolutely. You, not everybody's going to be Mozart, but everybody can bring out their potential. And the fact of the matter is, we have far more potential than we think we have. And of course, in the case of Mozart, well, people can always talk about genetics and other factors, but they were surrounded by music, they were influenced and programmed mm-hmm. from an early stage. Now, yeah. it's been shown that if you take people, and at the early stages, for example, with languages and other cognitive abilities and tasks, if they're surrounded by positive input, positive belief, their attitudes and their beliefs and then their outcomes are so different mm-hmm. to people who don't have that. And our job is to program people, if you want to use that word, to take their minds and therefore their performance.
Maybe to program their mind or to help them use more of their abilities and to eliminate
yes.
Wrong thinking. And maybe we can also teach leaders to be more transformational and to do those things with their workers and subordinates.
Yes.
And this is very important.
Yes.
And I think maybe next time we could talk more about leadership, transformational leadership.
Of course.
And more about enhancement. Right now I would like to thank you for coming and for sharing us some okay. of your vast knowledge in the field. And I'm sure that everybody who really learns from you can learn a lot and can really learn how to use more of his potential, whether it's leaders or corporations. And thank you so much for
all of us as leaders
coming here. So, John, if people would like to hear more about your talks and trainings and workshops, where can they find it?
If they go to our website at hypnotherapytraininginternational.com, they'll find out about our courses and information on talks that we give as well.
Thank you very much, John.
Thank you, Talia.